actually, the whole point is that the lived body has the ability to think and to represent and produce meaning. I even mentioned in the concept note, probably you all have access to that already, that the thought processes and the thought movements and dance movements facilitate and accelerate each other. So there was a Google form that was circulated for the event, for registering for the event, and I had a look at the responses. I see that all of you have come here with different expectations. Some of you want to know more about the form Sattriya. Some of you want to discuss the synergy of mind and body. Some of you have areas of interest that are similar to mine. There was one response which says, I want to look at how CWC hosts events. So that was that. So before we actually begin, let me do a quick exercise with you guys. I'm sure you know how the word association game works, right? So you will be given an original stimulus word to which you have to respond, a spontaneous response of the first word that comes to your mind. Because all of us have these conceptual mind maps that we have in our heads. That are conditioned by our different life experiences and cultures. So, for example, if I give you the word day, my spontaneous reaction would be say night or light, right, whatever. So, you get it, right? You get the drill. So, your stimulus word for today is, can we change the slide? It's dance. So please tell me, what are the words that come to your mind when you hear the word dance or you think about it?
Fifth floor.
Alright. Anything else?
Move.
Body.
Body, movement, happiness.
Dance.
Fifth floor. Space. Right. What else?
Embodiment.
Right, these are very interesting responses. Let's keep these in mind and carry forward our discussion on dance and communication from here. The next slide, please. So communication is a form of human behavior that is necessitated by the need to interact and communicate with fellow human beings. So there are these eight key ingredients according to Richard Porter and Larry Samovar that are involved in any kind of communicative exchange. They are the behavioral source, that is the desire to communicate. Then there's this encoding of the message by the author or the creator. Then the message itself. Then the channel through which that message is communicated. In the case of dance, that is the body. Then the responder, the audience, who will receive the message. The decoding, the internal processing in your heads of the message. The response, and finally the feedback, which work in a circular pattern, cyclical pattern, because then the feedback will again shape the behavior and so. So all this will make more sense to you when we discuss this and apply it in the field of dance. A very important question that is often discussed by dance theorists and otherwise is that, is dance a language? Next slide. So these are just some of the early responses to the question. When we talk about dance as a language, maybe language is used just as a metaphor. The metaphor may highlight that because dance employs gestures, body language, to communicate certain intention and emotion, so it is a language. So people jump in joy, or people shrug their shoulders in doubt, or when they are very angry, they raise their fists. So these body movements sort of communicate certain emotions, day-to-day emotions, which are also seen in the navarasas of the dance, like hasya or karun, or Rodra, or Vibhatsa. So the language metaphor is not really confined to the word language, but different devices in linguistics, like the very act, speech acts, or the written word, phrases, vocabulary, grammar, syntax, all of these can be seen in dance as well. So, for example, there are the hastas. Hastas are hand gestures. Pataka, Tripataka, Alla Padma. All of these are hand gestures that are used in the Indian classical dance forms. So, although these are mimetic, meaning, according to this mimetic approach, it will be like the reality is already present, the meaning is out there. It is only reflected by the body. So the body acts as a mirror to some reality that already exists. So, for example, if you use your hands like that, it will mean a bolt of thunder or lightning. And if you use your hands to make waves, it may mean a river. So, although it has this this function, there's also the symbolic function that probably has more value in dance. Because the objects that you try to depict with hastas, for example, a bee, the moon, a lotus, a flower, these can also stand for different emotions like longing. Fire can talk about passion and different emotions like these. So this means that in language, like we have metaphors and descriptive function, so also in dance we have these functions that can be done by the same hastas. And therefore, in the terminology of linguistics, dance also has these formation rules. Dance also has these anatomical and aesthetic restraints under which you have to work. The grammar, derivational rules, a lexicon. The next slide. Now we'll talk about the physicality as a powerful instrument in any human communicative event. So why is the... No, not this slide. I mean, you went too fast, I think. Please go back. Yeah. Thank you. So why is physicality such a powerful instrument in human communicative events? The answer may lie in the origin of human movement. When, as an infant, our first means of experiencing life is through movement or coordinating bodies, experts in nonverbal communication, they believe that the human movements stem from a combination of inherited neurological programs. Okay, and along with that, maybe also conditioned by culture, class, your location in this whole web of identities. So it is interesting to note the implication that not all non-verbal communicative transfers are culturally influenced, but in fact may even be genetically determined. So there's this one particular gene in humans that has been associated with an implied proclivity for dancing and social bonding. So taken together, this may suggest that social dancing, social bonding may even have a genetic origin. So when we talk about language, we talk about different dialects. In the case of dance as well, we may have different dance dialects. So there are these multiple dialects and languages that will communicate one particular idea variably across an audience community based on their own understanding and experiences of the body. So, because the body is the primary instrument of communicating dance, people of any cultural tradition will assert a degree of engagement with it, as they do perhaps, you know, in less stylized or less formal ways, use their bodies in communicating in their daily lives. Another important theory that has been proposed is that the origin of language lies in gestural communication, it doesn't have a vocal origin, but a gestural origin. And there's this evolutionary anthropologist and a developmental psychologist. His name is Michael Tomasello. He says that natural gestures like pointing or pantomiming are the best candidates for such an uncoded system of communication. And he dismisses any of the comparative data that has come up which points towards the vocal origin of language. And he says that these skills, these motives for shared intentionality evolved in the context of collaborative events and collective communal activities. So these very same processes for the capacity for language that humans have they also explain how we unconsciously sort of segment a dance performance into, say, phrases, paragraph, chapters and episodes. Another point is whether there is a universal movement vocabulary. About whether we have a physical lingua franca. So the universality factor versus these particular vernaculars and dance dialects is a debate where many even studies have been done, field trips and research, a lot of research has been done on this. And they say that the gestures and body language vary from culture to culture. For example, if you show a thumbs up in the West, it would mean, oh, good job, well done. But in certain cultures, communities in South America, it has very vulgar and nasty connotations. So apart from this factor, the face, facial expressions, that seems to have a pan-cultural element. These different dance languages and dialects take care of that, and in fact, even in the case of the Indian classical dance forms, there are 8 Indian classical dance forms. So it's like they coexist within a sort of, they are different flowers in a garden maybe, and they beautify the whole scene, and it is not important that we remain limited to this debate of whether we have a universal or a particularistic idea of movement and language. Next slide. These are monks from a satra in Majuli, it's a river island on the river Brahmaputra, and now I'm going to talk about the Sattriya dance. So there are 8 major Indian dance forms. The word classical is nowhere used by the Sangeet Natak Academy. So they are Bharatanatyam from Tamil Nadu, Kuchipudi from Andhra Pradesh, Kathakali and Mohiniyattam from Kerala, Manipuri from Manipur, Odissi from Orissa. What did I miss? Kathak from the Northern Belt, different states, right? And Sattriya from Assam. So Sattriya is the most recent to get recognized in 2000 by the Sangeet Natak Academy as a major Indian form. And we will discuss in detail, not about the technicalities of the form, I will not teach you movements, but I will talk about the social and cultural function that the dance served then and now. Next slide, please. So Sattras are Vaishnavite monasteries which were established by Shankaradeva. Shankaradeva is credited for bringing Vaishnavism from the realm of elite philosophical discussions to the realm of the masses. He wanted to make religion accessible to people. So his whole philosophy was about egalitarianism, liberalism and religion, doing away with all these elaborate ritualistic tendencies that was there in the then dominating Brahmanism. He wanted to come up with developed a language called Brajavali, because the common masses wouldn't understand Sanskrit and therefore they wouldn't get to access the real meanings in the texts that were given to them by the people in power then. So he developed this language because there would also be this an exotic kind of a feeling that the people would feel when they speak Brajavali, because it's not the normal, usual language they speak in their everyday lives. But it is also not as complicated as Sanskrit. So the sattras, there are different sattras in Assam. The main, the epicenter of the Vaishnavite tradition in Assam is Majuli, the river island. It is the world's largest inhabited river island, recognized by UNESCO, and is India's first river island district. So there are these two orders of sattras. In some, the monks are celibate. In others, they follow worldly lives. So, so the bhakti ideals that Shankaradeva wanted to propagate, he did that through the medium of the performing arts. So he developed this form called Bhavna, which is the Vaishnavite form of theater. And everyone would participate. The villagers, they would work in the fields in the daytime and they would come and practice Bhavna, rehearse Bhavna in the evening. So they would have a lot of fun. At the same time, they would be, they would get access to these ideas that they did not know existed before, that they can question certain social evils at that time. Because Shankaradeva's philosophy was about ethnic integration of the society. It was about spiritual upliftment. It was about societal reforms. So he adopted the means of the performing arts to do that. There were four important pillars to his philosophy: ekharon, nam, dharma. So these are guru, nam, hari, and bhagat. Guru is the guru Shankaradeva. Hari is the Lord. In Sattriya, the deity that is worshipped is Krishna. Bhagat are the bhakts. Shankaradeva, what he did, he brought them to the center of the whole system. After all, they are the ones who matter, the people, the subalterns. So the Namghar is a congregational prayer hall that is situated in the middle of the Satra premises. And it was not only a prayer hall, it served so many different functions. It acted like a center for performing arts. It acted like a library where you would find manuscripts and different literary texts. It acted as a village panchayat where people would sit and discuss issues of the village and solve them, and you know, in a very democratic manner. And women, men and children sort of almost acted as equals. There was no hierarchy. The whole point was about breaking away the hierarchies. So Sattriya as a form wasn't born as an independent dance form. It was always a part of the Bhavna tradition, the Vaishnavite form of theatre. So it was born out of the womb of the Bhavna form, and this project of actually extracting Kshatriya from being a theatre dance was done by Madhav Deva, who was Shankaradeva's foremost disciple. So I call Sattriya an umbrella art form because it is not merely dance. There is the character of the Sutradhar, the narrator in these plays, Bhavnas, Natas, who is almost an all-rounder. He will sing, act, play instruments, direct. So there's sculpture, there's music, there's literature, there's mask making. There is a whole range of art forms under this broad ambit of Kshatriya tradition. And Kshatriya is a beautiful combination of Margi and Desi elements. Margi means classical and Desi means folk. So although the entire, the broader part of the form is informed by the canonical texts that inform the other Indian classical dance forms, the Natya Shastra, Abhinay Darpan, Shankaradeva sort of adopted these local folk, tribal, indigenous elements into the form. For example, in the different hastas, they would be taken from the different tribal dances that existed during that time. And the names of the different Matiyakuras are ground exercises. And when I began learning the dance form when I was 6 years old, I was made to do only Matiyakuras for 2 years. These are 64 number of ground exercises. These are very, very difficult. And the names of different Matiyakuras are taken from, you know, activities of daily lives and household chores and things like that. So one is called Sereki Pak. Sereki is an instrument that is used in weaving. So it moves like that. So the Matiyakura that involves turns like this one. So it is called Sereki Pak. And likewise, there are so many, there are 64. So all these names have been taken from these local vocabulary. Dual personality today. So Kshatriya has traveled from the Namghar to the state, and that journey is very interesting. I say dual personality because it has to maintain two distinct identities today. Inside the Satras, it has still to be used as a religious practice, a form of worship, spirituality has to drive that. And outside the satras and outside the stage, when it is performed on stages, it has to be audience driven. It has to shed sort of its religious connotations. So Arshia Sethi is a dance scholar. She said the practitioners of the art form can be seen in the alignment of a tree. So the roots are these monks in the satras who have been preserving, maintaining, practicing the art forms in their respective satras. The trunk will be the monks that have come out of the satras, have settled in different cities and towns, have opened schools, dance schools to teach children in these different places, boys and girls. And the branches are people like me and my colleagues who sort of take the dance form to different cities, practice them, and sort of spread the message of the form. So for us to be able to do well, we have to look at the roots, the satras in Majuli. Majuli is sinking and shrinking. The situation is very bad, and the mobility of the people is bad. There's information deficit, there is communication deficit, trust deficit because of these reasons. And the people have to relocate to other places, whereby the whole essence of the form somewhere, in some senses, is getting lost. And that is a very sad development. The next slide. So now I am going to perform a piece. Before that, I would like to tell you this, that in any dance performance, there will be almost three layers of interaction. So the choreographer, my guru, late Dr. Jagannath Mahanta, he choreographed this piece. So he had a certain intention in doing that. I learned it, and maybe it has been 2 years. So now I read the piece in a different way. So there is my rethinking about the piece, and now I perform it in front of you, so you will think about it. So in the postmodernist tradition, there is Roland Barthes in his very controversial article, Death of the Author. So it says that it is the audience member who is the author at the end of the day, because I perform it and it will take on a life of its own. So immediately after the performance, I would like to know what your immediate reaction to the performance is, and then we'll talk about it in detail. So this is a piece that has been taken from Shankar Deva's play, Keli Gopal, and it depicts the heartbreak that gopis undergo when Krishna asks them to go back to their respective households and family lives and not be drawn towards him. The gopis are angered, they're frustrated. They ask Krishna, what is going on? Why are you doing this to us? How can you be so cruel? So I'm going to perform it and we'll discuss it afterwards.